Hello, and welcome back to another episode of Critical Reactions with your host, Brian. We're in the middle of Jazz Fusion / Jazz Rock Week, and we started off with songs leaning closer to jazz rock, and I think I'm more in the mindset for songs and bands like that. So hopefully I can go into the end of this week in the right mindset and approach all these songs on their own terms rather than what I was expecting out of the theme. Today we are going to be looking at something interesting. This is Bela Fleck. I think I'm pronouncing that correctly with the accent over the E. Bela Fleck and the Fleckstones, Live at the Quick. And the song is Lover's Leap. So I'm pretty excited about this. We're going to see how they incorporate jazz into their rock playing, hopefully. If anything was going to sort of go against that, it would be now that I've decided to kind of flip the switch on my brain and expect music like that. Let's get into this one though. I really love that sparse harmony. Yeah, real playful tone. We got a lot of emphasis on upbeats. That's gorgeous. Working in some of the core themes of the melody while putting his own spin on it. Oh, beautiful. Rising up to that. Nice sparse melody it's a cool contrast to what we got from the last soloist. Interesting. Ho 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 ho. first time we've heard a rising line into an octave tonic, so... Line underneath too. Yeah. All right, we bring back the opening melody. Response between three instruments that start to overlap and intertwine. Oh my god. So, that was phenomenal. That is more of what I was kind of expecting out of this week, and made me water up a little bit. That ending was gorgeous. Of course. I kind of get in the mindset for jazz rock, since that's what we've had since the beginning of the week. And finally, I'm like, okay, I've got the switch set. I'm ready for this. Let's get into some rock music with some jazz influence. And of course, we have straight up jazz here. keeping me on my toes. I talked yesterday about sort of the core idea in traditional jazz standards, in that you have your core melody line, then your solo section, and then you end on your melody line. And we saw that pretty much beat for beat here. And I really enjoy that. It feels, obviously, it's not fantastical composition there. It's two parts, the melody, the solo, and then we revisit the melody. It's nothing insane going on there, but it just feels so home to me, comfy, safe. I really love this composition style, because even though if we look at the raw building blocks, we have ABA, right? It's nothing insane right there, but there's so many really cool movements and ideas that exist within the solo sections themselves that really expand the song and bring it to life. Not to mention that every performance, I'm going to assume, is different. These felt like a series of improvised solos, and I don't really know how I can kind of get it across, how I differentiate. I guess it really has to do with how much they lean into group dynamics, because trying to get multiple people to do the same thing improvised, you got to be mind readers, or you just have to know the people very well. And here, this could very well have been pre-composed, but just the setting for it sounds like something where, I mean, it could have been improvised easily, and I figure if it can be improvised, it probably should be, especially given that this feels more like jazz to me than rock, which the last two songs we've checked out definitely have a stronger rock presence than their jazz influence, at least as far as I was concerned. So it's really nice to see this other side of the coin here. So the first thing I want to point out is the core melody that exists at the beginning and the end of the song. And it has this nice, chill, laid-back, almost like vacation vibe. Chilling on a beach kind of thing. You can almost hear a ukulele going along with this, and it just kind of fitting in perfectly. And so it's interesting, though, that there's such a difference to me between that core melody and some of the solos that we listen to, especially the guitar. I think it was a guitar. Could have been another stringed instrument. But we had quite a few runs in that, especially arpeggiated, climbing arpeggiated runs. And there's a lot more energy and driving force in that solo than in the pitched, I don't know what that was. It sounded like water drops, like pitched water drops. It was panned over to the left side, and I really don't know. I suppose it could be a sample on a keyboard, but I can't think of any acoustic instrument that sounds like that. But that definitely does not mean it does not exist. But yeah, so that instrument had a very sparse feel to their soloing. We saw very short runs and then lots of space between them. Especially, I think the cool thing was that it allowed some of the underlying foundational work to shine through a bit, which was pretty cool. I was going to go on a tangent about this Herbie Hancock solo I saw a few days ago about letting the foundational members get a chance to shine during a solo. But, I mean, we got a thing on task here. I could ramble about jazz like so much. So, yeah. And it's really cool just to see how these different solos bring different flavors and ideas to the music and different driving energies. The song is called Lover's Leap. And it's not plural Lover's Leap. It is an owner, a Lover's Leap. So it's interesting then that this whole song could be viewed as sort of a single person taking a leap into a relationship, and that's kind of the angle I want to take it, because I think that it works very well. We have the intro, which I said is very chill, very relaxing. That could be sort of the infatuation phase, and then the solo is all over the place. It's all sorts of ideas. We have driving sections, we have calming sections. We have these huge rises up to tonics that are octaves higher than where we started. And it happened more than once, so it makes me wonder. I can't remember if it was the same instrument both times. It could just be a nuance of that soloist. Maybe that's just how they like to play, right? But yeah, we saw that a couple of times, and I thought, you know, between that and then some of the sparser sections, like that percussion instrument, and then some stuff that kind of plays around in the middle with their soloing and how they deal with dynamics and drive and momentum and filling space or allowing space to exist. We see all these different emotions, and then at the end we get this really, really cool duet on our way out. Right, so what started with a lot of singular instruments kind of doing their own thing ends up with two instruments very much playing, you know, intertwined around each other, harmonizing and kind of filling in each other's gaps, and just really beautiful stuff. And Lover's Leap. Yeah, I don't know if that's necessarily the intention of the track, but those are the themes that I'm picking up on. And I think it's really cool how they find a way to take the old standard idea of, melody, solo, melody, and recontextualize it so that it can tell a story. Now, a lot of standards do kind of do this to an extent, but I don't think I've ever personally felt it as strongly as this. It's usually more of a reprise to end the song, because ending the song on a solo is difficult. It really depends on the experience of the players. But I find that especially your larger bands, we're talking about like a 20, 25 member band where you have multiple trumpets, violins, flutes, saxes, you have 4 to 5 people in your rhythm section. I find that it's easier to use a composed ending, even if it has to be the core melody that we established at the beginning, to really bring home that cathartic finale. That is not to say that you could not end a jazz song in a solo and not achieve a strong ending. You certainly could, but I just think it's easier and has less variables for creating less variables that could mess up an ending if you do it with a structure like this. So I like how they went about and took the core structure that we see in standard jazz or in jazz standards, and like I said, recontextualized it within the constraints of at least the story that I felt. And they brought back the core melody ideas with some variation and some embellishment and changed the way that it felt. It was still a lot of the core melodic lines, the same core chord progressions. But there were a couple of changes that altered the way that it felt. It wasn't so singular anymore. It felt like a duet. It felt like multiple instruments coming together to create a single idea instead of a single person creating a single idea. And it's just, I love seeing creative stuff like that where we take, rules that have been rules and, find ways to work them in thematically. Very cool stuff. A lot of really good work in here. And, like I said, it got me a little misty eyed there at the end. It was just real beautiful. And, good stuff. I'm definitely going to check out more Flexstones in the future. Those are my thoughts. So this is where you guys come in. Now hit me up in the comments. Let me know what you thought of Lover's Leap by Bela Fleck and the Flexstones. If there's anything that you enjoyed, anything that stuck out, maybe I missed something, and you want to let me know that you picked up on something that maybe I didn't get a chance to talk about, any sorts of comments are fine. Go ahead and drop them down there. Above that's description box if you'd like to support the channel out via Patreon, or maybe you'd like to join the Discord community and chat with everyone in the community. Fellow like-minded metal lovers, music lovers in general. It's not really a metal-centric community. There's a heart, a core of rock and metal that kind of ties everything together. But there are so many different musical genre enjoyment going on in the community, and we see all sorts of music popping up. Hey, I just found out about this, check it out. And it's like psychedelic funk. I'm like, wow, that's pretty awesome. And then somebody else be like, hey, I just found this one out, and it's like the brutalest death metal I've ever heard. And they were like back to back in 20 minutes. So it's a very cool community if you want to join that. The link is in the description. You can also like, subscribe, ring the bell. All three of those things help out the channel immensely. And I will be back tomorrow, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 p.m. UTC. With yet another critical reaction, doing more jazz fusion / jazz rock. We got two more to go. And so far the week has been pretty good. Even though I had to sort of reconfigure my brain at the wrong time, apparently. I guess I'll just come into tomorrow's video expecting either or, and just trying to adjust on the fly depending on whether we get jazz rock or jazz fusion. All right, well, Until next time, remember to be critical, not cynical, of the music you listen to, and have a fantastic morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever you choose to watch my videos.